We are starting our last slot of talks before the happy hour. And it is already happy hour because I have really a great pleasure to introduce Hasnaa Zidani from ENSTA, Paris Tech, should be added, and University of Paris-Saclay. Pardon, madame. And I'm really happy because we have been collaborating for many years already with Hasnaa, and this workshop gives us yet another opportunity to continue this successful collaboration. And she's here visiting, so this is really great. Thank you, Hasnaa, and thank you for your help with this setup. So she will talk today about Hamilton-Jacobi approach for some stochastic control problem with state constraints.
Thank you very much, Claudia, for this introduction. I am really delighted to bring my contribution in this workshop, and I'm really, really happy to give this talk here. So what I will talk about is some stochastic control problems, and I will focus on the approach called Hamilton-Jacobi Bellman. In the context where in the stochastic control problem it with the some state constraint. This is a joint work with Olivier Bokanowski and Athena Piccarelli. Both of them are present here. So this is the outline of my talk. I will give a small introduction to Hamilton-Jacobi approach. We had already several talks about this topic, and I will still allow myself just to give some recalls on this approach. And then I will spend some time talking about the swing options in energy market, which would be the main motivation for the work I will present in the third part. And the third part, finally, I will come to this state constraint stochastic control problem in a general setting. And I will show you the steps that we have to perform in order to deal with such control problems. So this will be just to fix the notations. I will work with the general controlled stochastic differential equations. So X will denote in my talk will be the state. I assume that I have this differential equation would be, this is the usual drift, sigma, the usual volatility, B is the Brownian motion, and I assume that this differential equation is controlled through this input function, which is a measurable function with taking values in a compact set. So this is very, very important to have a compact set in Hamilton-Jacobi setting. So I will assume that all my functions have nice properties and satisfy standing assumptions so that this differential equation has a unique strong solution. So this is something we have already seen in different talks this week. So what is the problem here? The problem is we would like to compute this value, the value function, which is the minimum of this cost. In this cost, I have two parts. I have here something which is depending on the final position. So this is the final cost. And here we have a distributed cost that depends on the state and the control. And we would like to minimize this expectation over all controls such that the trajectory itself belongs to a set K for every time, almost surely. So we are in the stochastic setting, and usually the most suitable maybe framework for the constraints is to have some probability on the constraints. But here I'm interested in the case where we would like this assumption to be true for any time and almost surely. So K, it's just a closed set, it's non-empty, and the cost function psi and the distributed cost L are given functions that could be very, very smooth. It's not an issue. So a particular case is just to determine, for example, remember the talk of Georgie when he talked about, so if you remember the Black and Scholes sitting, so if you have just, if you want the expectation of psi at capital T. So if we are looking to this value function, we know that this value function satisfies a PDE called Black and Scholes. So this is something known. So what I'm, a simple example without control would be to define the value when the trajectory remains in the set K. If it goes outside, then the value is plus infinity. And here we have a non-trivial problem already, because in this case we have to define also this free boundary of the set where from which we can have a trajectory that would effectively remain in the set K. So I will make this clearer in the future slides. So we are concerned by this problem. Before we go before I give you the motivation, I would like just to give some reminders here. So the first thing I would like to talk about is the deterministic case. Assume that we have no stochasticity and our problem is perfectly deterministic. So I have here a process that is, so what does it mean deterministic? Of course, it's just that I have no volatility here and I have just a differential equation. So in this context, and I assume that we have no state constraints. So what we want to minimize is this cost, which is a combination of a final cost and distributed cost. And it is known since the 50s that we have this dynamic programming principle that links what the value function at time t to the value function at time t plus h. And from this dynamical programming principle, we can already design numerical algorithms just to project this DPP on the grid and compute the value function. The problem if we do that is that this this minimization here would be somehow difficult to handle, because then we have to consider a finite number of realizations, and maybe this is not what we don't want to do if the space of controls error is very, very large. It could lead to a very large scalar problem. So if we want to go further in the theory, what we can do is to derive from this dynamic programming principle PDE. And this is the PDE that characterizes the value function if we have a very general hypothesis on the data, psi, L, and the drift to B. We can show that the value function is a solution to this PDE, where H in the control theory is called the Hamiltonian, and this is the shape it has. So the difference between the two is that here we take the supremum over the set of realizations, the set of values of the control, while here is still a function between t and t plus h. Anyway, we in some situations it's very convenient to have this PDE, because from there we can really have access to a very large panel of numerical methods, more than that than what we can get from the DPP. And also an interesting feature of this PDE is that it describes physically the evolution of the value function. So for example here, this P will represent the gradients. And when we see this in physics, we know that we have something what we call front propagation. So we can link this this PDE to some phenomena that we can also encounter in physics, and we can from there get some nice properties to the value function. Okay, this is how it works in the deterministic case, and the situation is quite similar if you have a stochastic sitting. So the stochastic sitting, now X is a process. So what we minimize here is the expectation. Then we have also a dynamical program principle that looks like that. It's almost exactly the same thing, apart that we have the expectation. And again, from this DPP, we can derive the Hamilton-Jacobi equation solution that is satisfied by the value function. Here again, we have the Hamiltonian. And since we have the volatility, leads to a new term in the definition of the Hamiltonian, which is this one. In the deterministic case, we had already the drift times the gradients, and now we have this 1/2 trace of sigma sigma transpose Q, which is which stands for the second the Hessian of V. So we have almost the same thing as in the deterministic case, and things are very well understood since the 80s, mainly due to the notion of viscosity solution. So the viscosity solution, so it's just a way to define the derivatives in a proper way, okay? So if you assume that your value function is smooth enough, you can just use differential calculus, elementary differential calculus, and get the equation. But usually the value function is not smooth enough, and the viscosity notion is a way to define the solution in a rigorous way, replacing the derivatives by something which is more evolved. So, and actually, the value function, I said, it's not always smooth. It, in general, it is merely continuous or Lipschitz continuous, if you don't have state constraints. If you have state constraints, then even the continuity is too much. So the viscosity, it turned out that this viscosity notion is also a convenient framework to study the numerical numerical schemes. And now we know that if we discretize the dynamic programming principle or the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, we end up with something, if the scheme is stable, consistent, and monotone, some properties that Olivier had introduced in his talk, then we end up with something which would converge to the right solution, the right value function, and we have also some error estimates available. Once the value function is known, is still it's interesting to notice also that from the value function we can define the optimal strategy, and the optimal strategy is the strategy that maximizes the Hamiltonian. Of course, once you have the value function and its first derivative and its Hessian, then you can synthesize the control feedback. So this is the notions that are now available. And in the simple case, again, this case where we have no control, we want just to know this expectation, you can use the same theory and prove that the value function is solution to the this partial differential equation called also Black and Scholes, introduced by Georgi. So this would be an example which is very, very well known. So now what I want to do is to try to define or to give a framework where we can describe the value function when we have state constraints in the sense of almost surely. So this is what we want to do. And we have a couple of interesting applications for that. So for example, the aircraft landing problem with wind disturbances, I think that Georges Pflouk know very well this this problem. We have some energy consumption with limited resources and different other problems coming from finance. So I would like just to present you a nice application linked to energy consumption because this is what I think would be more interesting for you. So let me then move to the other parts of my talk and present the swing options in energy markets. So in the energy markets, we assume that we have the price of energy. Let me call it Y. And this price energy follows this differential equation, stochastic differential equation. And here I have no control at all. So the energy, I have no control on the price, okay? It's given by this law. Now, what is the swing option contract? The swing option contract say the following. So you decide a time of maturity, and usually it's 1 year. And you have 1 year to practice your contract in the following way. In the contract, you specify also the a strike, a price. This is the price that you will be allowed to pay when you buy the energy, okay? You decide well ahead this price K, which is a fixed, and it will remain fixed during during the whole duration of the contract. Now, at every time S, you have the possibility to buy an amount U of U between zero and U buy at the price that have been decided at the beginning of the contract K. So this is not like this contract gives much more flexibility than the European contract or the American options. Here you can use this contract during any time between zero and capital T. Now, what the buyer would like to maximize is this integral. So this is the U, the amount that he has buy, that he has bought, and this is just the difference between the real price minus K. So it could be a benefit if K is lower than Y, but it's maybe also a loss. Okay? So he has decided already the price to pay, but compared to the real price, it could be this difference could be a loss or a benefit. So if we look only to this problem, I think.
Just a question.
Yeah.
US is in this interval, but once I buy US, at the next, the time, subsequent times, do I decrease the US I bought from UBAR? I mean, is there like a budget from which I'm taking away, or is it just kind of a fit?
Your question is too soon. The difference is that by the end of this slide, you will have your answer. Okay, for this problem, actually, okay, so just to answer, if I look at this problem as defined here, I would say that at each time you are allowed to go to buy between zero to U bar, okay, any quantity. And the solution, excuse me here, I forgot an expectation because why? Is of course, it's a process. And actually, the solution to this problem would be just to take U bar if the price is bigger than K and zero other ways. Okay? If since you want to maximize this this quantity, then each time the price is bigger than K, If you don't have other constraints, you just take the maximum if you see that the price is bigger than K. If it is lower than K, then there is, you can wait, okay? If we set the problem like that. So the thing is that actually we have these limited resources, okay? And the buyer cannot buy between T to capital T, actually between zero to capital T, cannot buy more than a certain amount M. And then if you add this strategy, the optimal policy becomes much more complicated. It would be, again, the same policy if U bar times capital T is, for example, less than M. Then this is still the this would be still the optimal solution. I am interested here in the case when this is not the case. So you cannot buy a U-bar each time the price is higher than K. Okay, now what is the link with the problem with the state constraints? So I will use now just this, okay, I have here this integral, this is just the summation of all the amounts about, and I transform this the previous equality just like a differential equation, and here I'm asking that this new state variable, I will consider this like a new state variable that should be between zero and capital M. So now, in my control problem, I have two state equations, y and zeta. So the first one is a stochastic process. The second one is deterministic. The control variable has to take values in this compact set zero u bar. We have some state constraints. And the formulation of the problem is just this one. We are looking to this value function which represents the infimum or the minimum of the cost under the condition that at every time or at the final time, we have this constraint which is satisfied. Here actually it's equivalent just to assume at the final time this constraint because U is positive. But in the literature, actually, the constraints are much more complicated because you may have some constraints at each time S, okay? So for example, during the 3 months, you are allowed to buy a certain amount, and then during the first semester, you can increase the total amount, but it's not always the same bonds.
And Hasnaa, are there constraints that couple time steps, S and S plus one, or it's only always at each S?
Consecutive S or in an interval, I mean. It's between T to capital T. It's still between T to capital T. And you ask this double inequalities to be satisfied at every S. Okay? This is then in the literature we call the swing options, and there is a huge literature on this topic. So these references here are only very few. Here they consider the problem in discrete time. And already in discrete time, if you don't consider that your price is given at every time, but you have you have the price at every day or every week, or then already in this context the problem is not trivial at all, and there are many contributions. All these contributions deal mainly with some numerical methods to solve the problem. In the continuous time, there are these contributions. And what I presented here is mainly related to the formulation of the problem as I presented here, is very well written in these two papers. In the paper by Carmonin and Tuzzi, they consider the case where you may have it's a discrete time, but with a denombrable number of times. So it's still infinite, but it's not a continuum. Okay, but in all these papers, people, they end up by using at a certain point some penalizations to handle the state of constraints, and it is not clear at all if it is possible to characterize directly the value function without using the penalization. So I have nothing wrong with the penalization, and apart that I'm not comfortable usually to use the penalization if I don't know what are the parameters, how to choose the parameters. And here it seems that it's really an issue. Anyway, what I will try now to do is just to propose another way to define to characterize the value function. And actually, if we look at the literature, so as I said earlier, in the unconstrained case, there is no problem to characterize the value function by a Hamilton-Jacobi equation. If you have this state constraints, then the main problem is the loss of regularity of the value function that becomes at most lower semi-continuous. And the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, you can write it, but there is no uniqueness. And there are many, many examples where the value function is not the unique solution to the Hamilton-Jacobi equation you write. So you write something, you solve it, but you have no guarantee that it is exactly your value function. What I will try here to do is inspired from this paper with Altarovici and Bokanovsky, where we just try to... Okay. Switch. Okay, I said that we will try to... It's inspired from this paper where we addressed the characterization of the value function in the deterministic setting. So we extended that to the stochastic case, and actually the extension, it's much more delicate in the stochastic setting than the deterministic case. So there are a lot of papers. I don't want to cite everyone, but this is some papers I like very much, where the value function is very well studied, and some characterization of the viability kernels, for example. The viability kernels is already the question that address it's the question to know what is the region from which we can start and be sure that we will stay in the set K. And this is already a problem by itself. There are many contributions by these people. The case where we have just a final state at the constraints are also studied here. And in all this literature, there are some compatibility or some controllability conditions that says that when you reach the boundary of the set K, you need a control that allows you to let the volatility vanish. Okay, so you should have a control when you reach the boundary, the volatility should vanish, which means that you have no diffusion anymore when you reach the boundary. And also you need some assumptions of in what is called inward pointing condition, meaning that when you reach the boundary, you should have a control that pushes you inside. In some examples, this is possible, but in many, many examples, it's really impossible to satisfy such compatibility conditions. And the case of swing options is one of those examples that do not satisfy the controllability condition. Okay. Now let me tell you about what we want how we want to tackle the problem. So we have three steps. I think I can just go ahead. So this is now, again, my control problem. I'm not focused anymore only on the swing options. I take, again, the general setting. We have here a stochastic differential equation, and we have this value function that we would like to describe. To make it simpler here, I just forget the distributed cost. I assume that this distributed cost is equal to zero. It doesn't change anything in the analysis. And so I have just a final cost to minimize, and there are always these constraints. That's the trajectory should be in K at any time, almost surely. So some assumptions, it's not important here. And it is straightforward. This is in the, I think in the optimization community, it's a very common to use this trick called the Chebyshev transformation. I think instead of minimizing the cost, you minimize just the real z that is above this this function. Okay, and now in this problem, I'm minimizing just one parameter z under two conditions. So earlier I told you that one state constraint is already a challenging problem. Now I put everything in the constraints. And the reason for that is that I would like, by doing that, I am trying to translate the optimal control problem into a reachability problem. So how will I do that? So first, notice that, okay, when I say that this expectation is lower than zeta, it doesn't mean that psi is lower than zeta, of course. Okay? So what we have is the following. We have from Ito's representation, we know that psi is the expectation plus this martingale. And now when I say that this expectation is lower than zeta, it means that there is a certain alpha, which is a L2 process, such that zeta is bigger than this quantity. Here I have the function psi and this quantity. So the expectation of this part is equal to zero. Okay, so now a new, I'm sorry, I have to introduce one more notation. The notation now is just this this process, which started at z, and this is just the integral of the function alpha, okay, that appears in this transformation. And in this way, again, saying that zeta is in greater than the expectation, it means that there is one function alpha, which is just L2, a process, such that at the final time, zeta is bigger than psi, and which means that the couple is in the epigraph of psi. Okay? So this is the transformation I made. And now I look at this reachability problem, or the backward reachability problem, is the positions x and zeta from which there exists a control u. Okay, this is the control I had in my original problem. A new control alpha, which is a L2 process, such that at the final time I reach the epigraph of the cost function psi. And at every time I have this, I don't touch to this equation, to these constraints. I keep these constraints almost surely at any time. By introducing this backward reachable set, I have this result. The value function is the infimum of the value function at tx is the infimum of a zeta such that x at zeta is in the reachable set. So it's just some transformations of the constraints. Remember, I wrote here all the constraints, and my my backward reachable set is nothing else than this. I wanted just to get rid of this expectation, and by using this Ito formula, I can write the reachable set in this standard form. Okay? So this was the first step. There is two more steps. Okay, the second step is called the level set approach. This is a very nice approach introduced by Osher in the 80s, Osher and Setian, to describe the reachable sets. And this is how it works. So we extended this a couple of years ago. We extended to the situation where we have the constraints, and this is what I will use here in the stochastic setting. So how it works is the following. We take a J psi, which is just this maximization, psi minus zeta, the maximum of C minus Z and zero, and the distance, and this function is just the distance to K. And I define this new auxiliary control problem where here I have no state constraints. In this control problem, we minimize, minimizing is this function g psi plus this integral. And what I'm interested in is just the region where this function w is negative. Why am I interested in this part? Because if this function w is negative, it means that I have a couple of controls, u and alpha, such that the maximum here would be negative, and this distance is negative, which means exactly that the couple would be in the epigraph of psi, and the state equation is satisfied. Which one? Which? This is two positive functions.
I can't parse the brackets, I guess. Maximum.
Yeah, the maximum of this.
Something at zero, okay?
Yes. So if it is equal to zero, it means that this is negative. And if this is negative, it means that x and zeta are in the epigraph. Okay? So you get the point. And if I have this distance, which is negative, sorry, this should be just the distance. If this is the distance and equal to zero, it means that we are in the set K over the whole time interval between T and capital T.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Well, you said that W had to be negative. And here you're saying that the infimum of something that cannot be negative plus something that has to be zero is negative.
No, actually W is always positive. And I'm looking at the region where it is equal to zero.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, sorry for that. Yeah, this is what I need. So the function that I have introduced here is conveniently introduced in such way I have an exact characterization of this set. Okay, so the level set approach introduced by Osher is something that instead of defining a set, the boundary of the set, you define the set as a level set of a function which is continuous. And here we have a control problem as the one I have introduced earlier. We have no state constraints at all. But what we do have is that in this new control, we have introduced a new input alpha, which is just L2 functions, which is unbounded control. And this is bad. This is bad because we had no theory available, no general theory available for such situations. So just to sum up for these two steps. The first step, I wrote I had this inequality saying that the value function is, this one. So I know that the value function can be computed if I know the reachable set. And in the second step, I'm saying that the reachable set actually is the zero level set of another value function. And this new function is continuous. And this, the only problem we have now is that the new control is unbounded. OK, so I will try to go fast. What is the main problem when we have this control unbounded? So if I want to use the general theory, as I recalled in the general setting when we have no state constraints, so you have now, we have now this state equation because I have introduced one more variable, zeta. The value function is this one. And if I write formally the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, it would look like this equation. So this is the Hamiltonian, where I am taking the supremum over the control U and the input alpha. So U is in a compact set, then there is no problem, but alpha is a real set, is in R. And the problem now with this Hamiltonian is that it may be unbounded. So we have to define a good notion to the solution here when this Hamiltonian is unbounded. And to do this, so this is just a small remark. You can put this derivative, time derivative inside, and we have this new formulation. Okay, but still, this function can be unbounded. And actually, this formulation H tilde has this form. We are taking the supremum over something which is a polynomial with respect to alpha. So this supremum would be equal to zero because this is what the equation, if I write it in a formal way, this is what it would mean, that the supremum is equal to zero. And it is when it is equal to zero, it induces some conditions on the coefficients A, C, and B. So in particular, this is equal to zero. So if I replace alpha by just this fraction alpha 2 over alpha 1, then by a simple calculus, I put this with brackets because it's not really an equivalence, but this is one step that should be looked at more carefully, but just trust me, this would work like that. If I replace alpha by alpha 2 over alpha 1, if I multiply everything by alpha 1 square, then we end up with this equality. And here we see that the supremum of this product is equal to zero, where here I consider the matrix with A minus B C, which means that starting from here, we can get that the upper eigenvalue of this matrix is equal to zero. Okay, this is just a very simple algebra, which if I use it for my purpose, would lead to something like that. I can define this operator with the A is just this quantity here. Minus B and minus B are the derivatives between X and Z, and this is just the second derivative with respect to Z. So we have this definition, it's not very nice, but with this definition, we can prove that the value function finally, it's a continuous viscosity solution to this Hamilton-Jacobi equation, which is not classical at all. So let me maybe just say a word what happened, for example, for this case when we add state constraints. Okay? So as I told you earlier, if you are looking just at the case without state constraints, the Black and Scholes equation says that this part is equal to zero. Now, I have added one more variable, and we end up with this, the eigenvalue of this operator should be equal to zero. We cannot guarantee anymore that this quantity is equal to zero. So if I write the equation, so you know that the eigenvalue is equal to zero if you have this characterization. So we can write the equation in this form. And just I can say a word for people who are interested in PDE. This is in this equation. We have the maximum over alpha 1 squared plus alpha 2 squared equal to 1 to this quantity. Here I have a second order term. This is the first order. So what happened here is that it's a generalization to the obstacle problems. If you take alpha 1 equal to 0, then the time derivative would disappear, which means that you end up with an elliptic equation. If alpha 2 is equal to 0, then you have a parabolic equation. So this is a very particular setting where the Hamilton-Jacobi equation that you end up with is something that is between a parabolic and elliptic equation. I think... more time? Three. Okay. So just to finish, maybe I can just give the main result. So the main result is that this auxiliary control problem has has a value function that is solution to a well-posed Hamilton-Jacobi equation. It is not a classical one, but we still have all the information we need to guarantee the uniqueness. So to sum up, I started with a control problem with state constraints. I told you that this is not nice and it's not easy to compute because we don't know the reachability problem. So this is why I recast this problem in a reachability problem. To do that, we had to add one more state component and also to add one unbounded control. In the deterministic case, for example, if you write things in the deterministic case, this control would not show up. So, okay, so once this is done, the second step is to characterize the reachability problem. And this can be done by another control problem, which is free from state constraints. And but still, this new control problem, despite the fact that it involves an unbounded control, you can still characterize the value function, and the value function is continuous, then you can again, use what we know in terms of numerical approximations. So I think I'm done. Thank you very much.